Okay, let's get started, guys. So what we were working on in the previous class was necessary and sufficient conditions of optimality for constrained optimizations. So I want to minimize a function fx such that h of x is equal to 0. H is a function from Rn to Rm. And in order to write the sufficient condition, the necessary and sufficient condition succinctly, let me define Lagrangian. So this is known as Lagrangian L of x lambda. So that is f of x plus h of x transpose lambda, or lambda transpose h of x. And x star is regular if gradient of hx star is full rank. And what else did we need? Oh, and vx star. V of x star is d such that gradient of hix transpose t is equal to 0 for all I in 1 to m. Okay, these were the three definitions we needed. So this is the set of first order feasible variation, the point, the definition of regularity, and this is a new term that we are defining in this class, which is Lagrangian. Okay, and so the necessary condition was x star optimal and regular implies there exist lambda star in Rm such that gradient x at x star of the Lagrangian is equal to 0. H of x star is equal to 0. This is sometimes also written as gradient with respect to lambda of the Lagrangian. So this is n equations, no, n plus m equations, n plus m unknowns. This is all a recap. You already have it in your notes. I'm still writing it on the board, but you don't necessarily need to write it. And the second is the d transpose second derivative of Lagrangian d is greater than or equal to 0 for all d in v x star, first order feasible variations. This was the necessary condition, and the sufficient condition was if x bar lambda bar satisfies 1 the derivative with respect to x and lambda of the Lagrangian is equal to 0. So that's the same as number 1. And for all d in p x star, d not equal to 0. Then this implies that x bar is locally local minimum and lambda bar is the corresponding Lagrange multiplier. Okay. these were the two results we have studied in the context of optimization problem of this type. And I want to make sure that I haven't missed out any important detail. Okay, so nothing has been missed in these set of equations. Okay, so these are the two results. We have proved this result using the penalty approach, whereas this result we haven't proved it and we don't intend to prove it because the proof is also equally long. It's as long as this proof in order to prove sufficient condition. But you kind of know why this should be true, because no matter which first order feasible variation, feasible direction you take, no matter how small of a step you take, you know that your cost is only going to increase along the constrained surface. Okay, so therefore this must be, x star must be a local minimum, and lambda bar would be the corresponding Lagrange multiplier. If your original function was convex and your h of x is a linear constraint set, then of course any point that satisfies sufficient condition is also optimal. So convexity, again, convex function with linear constraints, it gives you this point x star is always optimal, globally optimal. Okay, any questions so far on this stuff? It's, yes. Oh, so you are saying that let's say you are doing an optimization problem over a set like this.
Right, but you could also have to draw and multiply the spans, say, R.
Yeah, so that would, in that particular case, you will have a GX less than equal to zero constraint too, which we will talk about it in a few, maybe in the next class. Okay, so you can take care of more general cases also. And we'll talk about it in subsequent class. Any other question? Yes.
What is the meaning of the x bar comma lambda in the sufficient condition?
Oh, this is not x bar. So this is just saying gradient of x and gradient with respect to lambda. So this is a compact notation for showing both the things. So. So gradient of x comma lambda of Lx lambda, gradient of with respect to x of L, and then gradient with respect to lambda of L. Okay, and what I'm saying is this should be equal to zero, which is the same as giving you this condition. Okay, no difference. Okay. The purpose for today's class is to perturb the constraint a little bit and then try and see how the solution of this minimization problem change, you know, as you perturb the constraint U. So that's what we are going to talk about today. So let me show you a picture. I have this is my constraint surface, h of x equals to zero. And then I change h of x equal to zero to some other constant vector u, okay, h of x equal to u. What does that imply for this surface? I'm just going to tilt this surface a little bit and move the surface a little bit. So maybe my new constraint looks something like this. This is my h of x equal to u. And earlier, of course, this was my x star. Perhaps after I have perturbed, my x star certainly would move. So this is my x star of u. Okay, so x star now is a function of u. And since I have perturbed the function, perturbed the constraint set a little bit, my optimal point would also move. And so the goal is to study the movement of this optimal point and, of course, also the optimal value. Okay? Now, the reason why sensitivity theorem is important is in many cases, well, not many cases. Let's consider a specific case of economic activities where you want to minimize the cost of production subject to the supply equals to demand constraint. One of the classical theories in economics says that you should always charge. So let's assume that the cost is convex, okay? You are studying a similar problem right now, the fourth problem that you are looking at, which is the electricity market problem. It's actually a market problem where you want to minimize the total social cost subject to supply equals to demand constraint, right? I don't know how many of you have attempted problem number 4 or 5, whatever that problem. How many of you have attempted problem number 4 on the homework 3? A few, okay. Okay, all right, so those of you who haven't attempted so far, I would highly urge you to start working on your assignment 3 because it's going to take way more time than you actually think it is going to take. So perhaps it will destroy your next 2 days if you don't start today. Okay, anyways. So in that particular problem, the idea is that you want to minimize the total cost of producing electricity minus total willingness to pay for the electricity subject to supply equals to demand constraint. One of the classical theories in economics is as follows. If your cost of production is convex, then the cost for the commodity should be equal to the increase in total cost if you increase the unit of production by 1 unit. Okay? So let's consider a more concrete example. Let's say I want to manufacture these chalks, and I presume that the demand for chalks is about 1 million chalks per year. Okay? So I set up a factory, and I look at my cost of producing these chalks and assume that the cost is convex. So the more chalks you create, it's the higher the cost is going to be. And then after I have produced 1 million chalks, the question that I have to face is how much should I charge each customer for this one chalk that I've produced, for the chalks that I've produced? And one of the famous ways of pricing an item or a commodity is to say, let's look at the cost, optimal cost of producing 1 million chalks, and let's look at the optimal cost of producing 1 million and one chalk. Okay? And I'm going to take the difference in that optimal cost. So that's known as marginal cost of production. So that's the cost of producing one additional unit of item. And that should be the price of the item. Okay, and that's what you see in your day-to-day activities. That's the cost of every item that you have ever bought. Well, not every item, but most of the items. In fact, the electricity is actually priced in that specific manner. So when you look at your electricity bill, you will see that the cost of electricity is whatever, 5 cents per kilowatt hour. And that's the marginal cost of production of 1 unit of electricity, 1 kilowatt hour of electricity. So that's what you actually pay. So I don't know how many of you have looked at your electricity bill, but next time you see it, notice what the cost of production is, and that's what it's $0.05, at least in Columbus. That's what the cost is, the marginal cost of producing the electricity. There are, of course, certain economic activities where the cost is not convex. And let me give you another example from the electricity industry, which is the cost of distribution of electricity, okay? So in order to distribute electricity, you have to set up the whole distribution network. You have to set up transformers. You have to set up substations. You have to run lines all the way from transformers to the houses. So there is a huge investment cost. But after that, there is no cost of transferring electricity from the point of generation to the point of consumption. So in that particular situation, there are other economic ways. There are other theories that tell you exactly how to price those items where the marginal unit of production or marginal cost of moving one unit of electricity is actually zero, okay? So in that case, you can't really charge zero price to the end user. The current debate, so my goal is to tell you, in electricity, the way it is produced, you are essentially charged the marginal cost of production. And that's what sensitivity theorem tells you, what the marginal cost of production is going to be. In the distribution, you don't pay the marginal cost because the marginal cost is zero. The marginal cost of moving 1 kilowatt hour of electricity from generator to your house is actually zero because the distribution, entire distribution network has already been set up. Nobody has to actually put fuel or do anything about moving this electricity to your home. But there is one area where there is still a lot of contention as to how to price the commodity, and that is public transportation network. The cost of moving one passenger from here to Dublin on a public bus, on a public transportation bus, is actually zero. Nobody has to do anything about, nobody has to put in any effort in order to move you from this point to any other point in the city. So technically, by the economic theories, the entire network has already been set up. The buses are already running on time. So each of you should actually be asked to pay $0 to actually take a public transportation service. But in fact, you always have to pay like $1, $1.50, $2 or whatever. And there is quite a bit of debate going on in the transportation area about how to price a public transportation service, okay? And it's actually a very fascinating debate. I don't know how many of you are interested, but you can probably go to Google Scholar and look for articles which say how to price public transportation, and then other articles which says how marginal cost can be used to price public transportation services. And it's really a very fascinating debate that you should probably, after studying sensitivity theorem, you should actually go back and think about it. Okay, so that's the use of sensitivity theorem, at least one of the major uses of sensitivity theorem in modern economics. So what is sensitivity theorem? Let me write it somewhere. I am going to name it J of U, which is the optimal value when Hx is equal to U. I'm going to assume that F and H are differentiable, F and H are infinitely differentiable. And the sensitivity theorem is X star 0 be optimal and regular, lambda star 0 and X star 0 satisfy all sufficient conditions for optimality then for u small, x star u, lambda star u are differentiable. Gradient of j of u is equal to minus lambda star of u. So this is marginal cost on this side, and this is Lagrange multiplier. On the other side, and there is a negative sign that you shouldn't miss. Okay, so marginal cost is equal to negative of Lagrange multiplier. So when you solve your electricity market problem, let's say using the LinProg functionality in MATLAB, you'll actually find that the Lagrange multiplier would be the same as marginal cost. You can do the testing on your own, and you will actually see that this is indeed the case for that particular problem. Okay. Any questions so far? Okay. So let's look at the proof of this particular result. And the proof relies on implicit function theorem, which I am going to discuss now. So what is implicit function theorem? I have a function p from u cross v to v. Assume u, v are all open subsets of Euclidean spaces. Pick u in u, v in capital V. If, let me pick u bar and v bar. If gradient of v of p u bar v bar is invertible, then there exists a differentiable function function, let me call this phi, from u to v, such that p of u phi u is equal to p of u bar v bar. Okay, let's look at the picture. So I have this set. This is U. This is V. I pick a point U bar, V bar in the set. This is all, by the way, this is all in the neighborhood of U bar and V bar. Okay, so there will be a small neighborhood around U bar and V bar. So this is not the precise statement. There is a lot of things that goes on in the statement. But this is the main crux of the statement, and it holds in the vicinity of U bar and V bar. Differentiable function says that this in the vicinity of U bar, V bar. Okay, so don't think of it as a global result. This function is not defined globally. It just defines in the neighborhood of U bar, V bar. So I pick this point U bar, V bar. Then there exists a differentiable function in this area around U bar, V bar. So there is this differentiable function. This function is phi of U, such that the value of the function along this curve is exactly equal to the value of the function at this point. Okay? So P of U phi U is equal to P of U bar V bar. Okay? So the value of the function doesn't change along this curve. But the important thing to note here is that this function phi is actually differentiable. Okay? And it follows from differentiability of the function p. Okay? Have any of you seen this implicit function theorem before in the context of a two-dimensional space? No? Okay. We are not going to prove this result. The proof is fairly involved, and it's there in the book in the appendix. Well, actually, the proof is not there in the book, but perhaps in some differentiable manifolds book, you will be able to, some undergrad text on manifold theory, you will be able to find the proof of this particular result. But we are going to use it in order to prove the step number one. We need that. We need this result to prove that. Okay, so once again, I want to tell you why this function is important. I have a differentiable function. I pick any point in that set. I'm going to assume that the gradient of this function P with respect to V is an invertible matrix. It is going to be a matrix because this is in, dimension V cross. It's a matrix in dimension V cross dimension V. It only needs to be invertible. I don't care whether it's positive definite, negative definite, or whatever. Just has to be invertible. Then there exists a differentiable function, phi, such that the value of the function P doesn't change along this curve. Okay? It remains the same. And this is in the neighborhood of U bar and V bar. So let's see how to apply it for, yes?
Could you say the same thing, but with like V instead? Like phi of V.
Phi of V? What do you mean?
If you're using U in this case, can you go
out? Oh, so then you need to just mention, so this function has to map from U cross V to U. This has to be derivative with respect to U. Then you can switch it, okay? Yes? It's a neighborhood of U bar, V bar. Okay. Any other question?
How did you define phi of U?
I didn't define. There exists a function. It's an existence result. So there is one differentiable function so that you can, no matter where you, which point you pick here, the value is going to be the same as the value at this point. Okay. In this entire curve, yes.
They are the same.
They are the same. Okay.
So U bar and V
It can be any point in the set. The only problem is this has to be invertible at that point. Okay, can be any point. Okay, so let's use, yeah.
So does that neighborhood has to be like a size epsilon? Can it be like, can epsilon be like anything, or it has to be small?
That's a good point. Okay. So let's assume that this is invertible everywhere throughout the space. I'm inclined to believe that this would, the epsilon would extend to the entire space. Okay, but if it is not, or maybe I'm wrong, yeah. So sometimes what happens is, what's the actual result? The actual result is there exists a differentiable function and neighborhood of u bar and v bar such that this holds true in that neighborhood. Okay, now the size of the neighborhood is not part of the statement of the theorem.
Okay. Is it just the size in which that it's invertible?
Yes. That's the only assumption. Now the problem is whenever you have a nonlinear function, your gradient could be invertible here, but it may not be invertible at some other point. And therefore, you can't really talk about global result. You can only talk about local result when you're using implicit function theorem. And in fact, in the case of sensitivity theorem, we are only going to consider the case where u is small. So we are only interested in a local result, not a global result. If you want to create a global result out of this, I'm pretty sure you will have to strengthen some conditions here in order to make sure that you can have the same result locally everywhere, and then you can bootstrap the entire solution throughout the space in order to get the solution for the entire space. Okay, but it requires perhaps a more involved argument. And I have not seen a global implicit function theorem so far, perhaps because it's not very useful, but I don't know. I just haven't seen it. Yes, and that's differentiable.
Okay,
so it's important. The important part here is the differentiability part. Okay, yes.
So if u v was like a local minima,
yes,
your manifold would have a differentiable.
That's right, minimum. Yes, yes. As long as this is invertible. Okay, so these are like some small applications of this implicit function theorem. All right. So now I want to use this result and I want to conclude this particular part. So let me define my P. So I need to define U and V. Now the cool thing is U is the same as this U, okay? That's why but V is equal to x cross lambda. So V is equal to Rn cross Rm, which is equal to, well, and the small v is equal to x comma lambda. And my gradient of V, oh, and what is my P? My P of u comma x comma lambda is gradient of x l x lambda and then h of x. I need something more. I need u bar to be equal to 0. I need v bar to be equal to x star at 0 and lambda star at 0. Okay. So what is my P of U bar V bar? Can someone tell me what my P of U bar V bar is? Remember that X star is the optimal solution and lambda star is the corresponding Lagrange multiplier. So what happens to the gradient of Lagrangian at X star and lambda star? Zero. And what happens to my H of X star? Zero, right? So this is equal to zero. It's a zero vector. Okay, P of U bar V bar is a zero vector. And what's the dimension of this whole thing? So what is this? What is the dimension of the gradient of the Lagrangian with respect to x? Anyone remembers? Lagrangian is a scalar function, right? And you're taking the gradient with respect to a vector. So what's the dimension of this derivative? Rn. And how many h? What's the range of h? It's Rm. So this is in Rm. So I'm mapping. So I have a function p that maps u, v to v. And I pick u bar and v bar judiciously. So p of u bar v bar is equal to 0. These functions are differentiable, like infinitely differentiable. That's our assumption from the very beginning of this class. So all functions are differentiable multiple times. So what does implicit function theorem tell us? There exist x star and lambda star as a function of u such that these two derivatives is equal to 0 throughout. So let me write it more formally. So implicit function theorem implies there exists phi of u, which is x star of u and lambda star of u, which is differentiable, such that gradient of x, l, x star of u, lambda star of u, and h of x star of u is equal to 0. And phi is differentiable. Okay, there's only one thing which we still need to show. We haven't yet shown that this is invertible. Okay, but let's assume that it is. Not assume, it's actually invertible, but we'll get to it in a bit. Okay, for the time being, just be convinced that once we get to that particular point, we will be able to show that the derivative of this function with respect to x lambda is invertible. Okay, we'll get to it in a bit. But for the time being, just assume that it is invertible. Then I can apply the implicit function theorem, and I can conclude that there exist x star u and lambda star u, which satisfies the first order necessary condition for optimality, and x star of u and lambda star of u, both of them are differentiable. So that proves the first part. And then I need to prove the second part, which is gradient of j of u is equal to minus lambda star of u. So this is all for u small. And that's because this is a local result. Now my question to you is, if u is small, can I assume that x star u and lambda star u are optimal solution and Lagrange multiplier pair? Is it okay to assume that if u is small? Why should that be the case? So implicit function theorem hasn't, it only says that there exists such a function which is differentiable and it's equal to zero, okay? So the derivative is equal to zero. My question is whether it is optimal. Optimal solution and Lagrange multiplier pair. What do I need to show if I want to show that it is optimal? What exactly is it that I need to ensure? Go over the sufficient conditions for optimality. Okay. What does it require? Okay. So what does sufficient conditions for optimality require? Well, it requires these two conditions to hold. What's the second condition to hold? What's the second condition that we need to make sure? The second derivative condition, right? So if u is small, so we know that, let me write it here. We know that this holds. Now if I perturb it a little bit, this whole equation is not going to change by much. So if this is strictly positive, then small perturbation will also be strictly positive because this is all continuous function, okay? So in fact, x star u and lambda star u satisfy sufficient conditions for optimality as long as u is very, very small, okay? Okay, so let's go over the train of thought again. So I have x star 0 which is optimal and regular. I have lambda star 0 and x star 0 that satisfy the sufficient conditions for optimality. Then for small values of u, x star u and lambda star u are differentiable. Okay, so first we tried to put everything in the implicit function theorem form. Once we did it, we readily concluded that there exists a differentiable x star u and lambda star u that satisfies the first order necessary condition for optimality. And this is a differentiable, this phi is a differentiable function. We still haven't made sure whether x star and lambda star is optimal solution Lagrange multiplier pair or not. But in fact, we realize that since the second derivative of Lagrangian is continuous, if I pick any first order feasible variation and I perturb this 0 a little bit, so this is x star of u and lambda star of u, I'll still have this condition hold true because this is a continuous function. If d transpose continuous function d is strictly positive, then for small perturbations, it is still going to hold true, and therefore, x star u, lambda star u satisfy the sufficient conditions as long as u is small. So therefore, this is differentiable and locally optimal. There was a question, yeah.
So if I have a function that is a quadratic function, in that case my Lagrangian is also a second order.
That's right.
So in that case, we don't need to be worried about the fact that u is small or
That's right. This will be true everywhere. Yeah. In fact, for second order function, no, quadratic function and linear constraint, you can actually solve it by hand, and this is your assignment. Assignment question number one. The current assignment, homework 3. Okay, the class is going along with the homework. Okay, so you should start doing the homework as soon as it is assigned. You will understand much better what's happening in the class. Anyway, so once you do homework 3, assignment problem 1, for quadratic function and linear constraint, you can actually see by inspection that this holds true. Okay. In fact, J of u would be a differentiable function of u in your, if you go through the expression for the quadratic optimization problem. Okay. All right, so we have the first result. Let's look at the second result, and I'm hoping we have time. Yes, we do. I'm going to erase this this part of the board. So since x star u and so this is so this comes from, this is my gradient of x l of x star u and lambda star of u. So that's this equation. Okay, since the first derivative of Lagrangian should be equal to 0, I have this expression. Okay. What is gradient of, with respect to u, of f of x star u? This is gradient of u, j of u. And this is given by this is my equation 1. Okay. So j of u is equal to f of x star u. So therefore, I take the derivative on both the sides. And this is the chain rule. This is the chain rule. Now, the second result I have is h of x star u is equal to u. Taking the derivative on both the sides, I have gradient of u, h of x star u equals to identity. This is my second result. Yes.
But didn't we write here h of x star u equals 0?
This second one?
Yeah.
I'm using it. Oh, let me see. You're right. It should be equal to u. Oh, it should be equal to 0 u. Okay. Yeah, you are right. So this should be equal to u. So let me think where the implicit function theorem So let me get back to you on this in the next class. I don't quite know why the implicit function theorem says that it should be equal to zero. Let me get back to you in this in the next class, okay? So you are right, this should be equal to u, at least I need to see how the author has used implicit function theorem here. Okay, so in the proof for implicit function, well, in the statement of implicit function theorem, it says 0, 0. But in this particular case, it's supposed to be 0 u. So I have to see how, where there is a confusion in the write-up. I'll get back to you on this. Okay, so let's continue our train of thought. So I have this particular condition from here. I have j of u equals to f of x star u, so I can take the derivative on both the sides, and using the chain rule, I get this expression. I have h of x star u equals to u, so that implies this by, I'm applying the chain rule again, but this is equal to identity because the gradient of u of u is equal to identity matrix. So that gives me the second expression. Now, I am going to multiply this expression by gradient of u x star u on both the sides. And what I have is, so substituting 1 and 2 into gradient of u x star u, gradient of L we get gradient of u j u plus lambda star of u is equal to 0. And that implies second result. Okay. The operational meaning of Lagrange multiplier in an optimization problem is now clear. A Lagrange multiplier encodes information about how is the optimal value of function going to change if you perturb the constraints a little bit. Okay. So suppose you have solved a very complicated optimization problem, and you figured out that f of x star is equal to some value, let's say c. And in due course of time, your constraints were perturbed a little bit, and you are interested in knowing what the new optimal value is. You can always make this approximation where f of x star of u is f of x star minus lambda star transpose u. Okay, that's the first order approximation of the optimal value. And so you don't necessarily need to recompute the optimal value if your perturbation u is sufficiently small, because that first order will be quite close. It will be a very good approximation. Okay? So in the next class, there are two things we need to show. The first is that the hypothesis of implicit function theorem holds. which is that the gradient of Vp has to be equal, it has to be invertible. So that's number one thing we want to show. Number two thing we want to figure out is, how does implicit function theorem imply that this should be equal to u? So that's something I need to check. So that's all I have for today, and we'll meet again on Wednesday. Thank you.
Getting a view of f(x) or u equals.